Hi, this is Eleni Apostolidou. I teach history didactics at the University of Ioannina, Western Greece. Let me share a PowerPoint with you. So this is one of the video provocations in the series of past forward international conversations about history education. The title of my provocation is a question: is school history only a type of public history? The argument being that while public historians usually focus on public history products, history educators and history didactics researchers usually focus on learning and perceiving processes on the part of the students. To answer the question, we have to compare public history and school history. Now, a common thread shared by public history and school history is that they both address non-specialized audiences. Especially for school history, it always constituted a popularization and vulgarization of historical knowledge. In this sense, history education has always had a close relationship with historical culture, even popular historical culture. More than ever, history in school is mediated today by historical culture, material culture, digital means, and drama. Practices from non-formal educational environments are transferred in school. Even international organizations involved in history education nowadays produce material to be downloaded to students' digital appliances. Here we have two examples from Europeana. The first is about World War I, and the advertisement says that whether you are a school student or a World War I enthusiast, you can now discover the different causes leading to the First World War with our new iTunes U course and multi-touch book. And again from Europeana, the Jiffy Tap, it gives students famous paintings, and whenever they click on the link, the painting is livened up. Film, painting, theater, sculpture, toys, even social media can and often do communicate aspects of the past. This is what Jeremiah McCall says in his 2019 paper, from which I have taken this paper, this picture. I think that this picture gives us the panorama of historical culture. On the top left, one can see a screenshot from the video game Revolution. Then we have a picture of the famous painting La Liberté de Delacroix, which is which a student can find in Wikimedia Commons. Then we are having a screenshot from the webpage from the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Then one can see the webpage of the East Indian Company. Again, a screenshot focusing on history of fine foods. Then other pictures and other screenshots from other video games like the Assassin's Creed. And finally, a Playmobil history set. Another reason now why school history and public history share, have things in share, another common thread that they share, is their connections with politics. As for history education, can be considered to be public history because of the curricula. The enact governmental education principles and aims in schools, they serve specific aspects of communal national coherence and citizenship. And they do that by enforcing specific, usually national master narratives. This is the reason why Carretero, Mario Carretero, who is a researcher in history didactics, gave the following title in his paper: Imagining the Nation through school history master narratives. This is the reason why history education gives birth to public conflicts that may appear in different forms in several countries. The later history education wars are another connection between public history and history education. The later wars constitute also a blooming sector of research in history education and public history. Here we are having four collective volumes focusing on conflicts in education: history wars in the classroom, contemporary public debates over history education, and others. Two other examples, a paper written by Keith Crawford about the English curriculum that created a controversy in the 80s and the 90s, A History of the Right, the Battle for Control of National Curriculum History between 1989 and 1994. And on the right, we have a book in Greek about textbooks, history textbooks withdrawn in Greece in the centuries 19, 20, and 21st. Two more papers about textbooks withdrawals in Greece. One has to be aware of the context on the history education context in Greece to understand why I focus on these publications. In Greece, for many years, there has been only one obligatory history textbook, and in other lessons also, for each class, for each age at school. So teachers do not select the textbook they would like, they would wish, but have an obligatory textbook. When the later textbook does not respond to each government's wishes and ideology and current interests, it might be withdrawn in a way that finally educational products are decided by politicians and not by specialists. On the left, about history textbooks withdrawals from the 1980s, and on the right, we have a paper about a specific history textbook withdrawn in 2006 and causing a turmoil. We are also having controversies about curricula. In Alberta, Canada, we have an article on press, an opinion article. We are seeing the Minister of Education, and the title says proposed social studies curriculum changes are outdated. That was the opinion of the specialist. On the right, we are seeing the Minister of Education in Greece, and then we are having an article written on the part of the specialists in history education, accusing the current Minister of Education of having withdrawn the curriculum of the previous government to enforce a new curriculum. Now, to have a synopsis, we shall start from the right. We shall have a discussion on the three different types of public history, and we shall see how they relate to history education. The first type of public history is the one that academics may address non-specialized audiences. And this is a common thread between history education and public history. The second type of public history is memory studies or its evolution. This shares common aspects with history education in two ways. History education produces cases to be studied by public history, like when we are having controversies about curricula or history textbooks. Second, history education uses case studies from the public sphere to be deconstructed by students in the classroom. Finally, we are having public history from below, like oral history, and this can also be transferred in history education when students act in the classroom as public historians, like public historians. Now, in which ways history education has something more to offer than public history? In two ways, because it connects to history didactics research, also to historical consciousness research. History education is supported by research in history didactics, and the later research has focused for long, since the Piagetian times, throughout the 1970s and the 1980s till now, in students' learning processes and on processes more of perception on the part of the students than on production on the part of policymakers, like curricula and history textbooks. History education also connects to research in historical consciousness. Researchers of historical consciousness describing the concept of historical consciousness speak of the following advantages. With the four different types of historical consciousness, one overcomes the tension between heritage, memory, and the discipline of history. Or different types of historical consciousness help us to have insight to additional meaning-making processes. In this way, history education focuses on historical thinking or non-historical thinking processes on the part of the students. Again, we are having a focus on the thinking of the students, not on the production of history, but on the thinking and the perception of history as realized by students. Green. Historical consciousness allows space for individual differentiation. And then she makes a question. To what extent can we assume that collective memory, even when sanctioned by the state, is necessarily received by members of the public in the ways intended? Ribbons and Haydn states that just because you have taught it, this doesn't mean that they have learned it. So what is produced is not received in the same way. Kansteiner, just because traditional media deliver stable, coherent, and linear narratives at the point of distribution, this does not mean that these linear stories are reproduced at the point of reception. And Grever, speaking about collective memory, but generally describing historical consciousness that is based on aspects of collective memory, by focusing on the rhetoric of community, Halbach failed to notice how individual memories can come together to form a group memory through the medium of actual social interaction, as for example, in the telling of stories and the exchange of recollections between individuals. To have a synopsis, history education as realized in schools and history didactics as history education being studied in the universities focus to a great extent on individuals and differentiate among individuals levels of performance needs as regards teaching in the classroom. Mathesis, learning and its preconditions seem to be of additional interest to history education, apart from the production of historical narratives. And citing from my notes from grad's conference, educators, as for the future of history didactics, suggested the following, more empirical research in the development of historical consciousness, more empirical studies on how people receive other countries' cultures, more empirical research on historical consciousness, focusing on individuals and combining psychology, sociology, and social psychology. That was all. Thank you for your attention, and I'm waiting for your comments on Twitter.